Good morning and welcome to Hope Lutheran Church in Chino Valley, Arizona. We're glad you're joining us either by live stream or here in person this morning for our worship on this last Sunday before we begin the Lenten season. Today is also known in the church year calendar as St. Valentine's Day. And what most people don't remember today is that Valentine was a physician and he also was a pastor in Rome. On this day in the year 270, he was executed for his faith in Jesus. And that's really what this day was supposed to be about in the church year. It got turned into other things that I'll share later on. But today, we're going to take this day as a special day to revisit what God says about marriage and relationships. I thought it might be a little cute to do that on Valentine's Day. So God bless our worship today as we look at the roadblocks to a healthy and blessed marriage or relationship. God bless your worship today. Let's begin with the very first hymn for this morning, which is, O Blessed Home Where Man and Wife. Please arise. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We have come into the presence of God who created us to love and to serve Him as His dear children, but we have disobeyed Him and deserve only His wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to Him and plead for His mercy. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my guilt and take away my guilt. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all your sins, By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, he has removed your guilt forever. You are his own dear child. May God give you grace and strength to live according to his will. And now in the peace of the forgiveness we have in Jesus Christ, let's join to praise the Lord. Let us pray. Gracious Father, keep your family, the church, always faithful to you, that we may lean on the hope of your promises and be strong in the power of your love. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated. Our first lesson for today comes to us from the first book of Moses, known to us as Genesis, portions of chapter 1 and chapter 2, where we see how God creates man and woman in his image. He creates them with a purpose and teaches Adam about his great need for a helper and then establishes marriage. God said, "Let us make man in our image according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the sky and over the livestock and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that crawls on the earth." God created the man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth." God said, "Look, I have given you every plant that produces seed on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that bears fruit that produces seed. It will be your food. To every animal of the earth, and to every bird of the sky, and to everything that creeps on the earth in which there is the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food." And it was so. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. There was evening and there was morning, the sixth day. The Lord God said, "It's not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper who is a suitable partner for him." Out of the soil, the Lord God had formed every wild animal and every bird of the sky, and he brought them to the man to see what he would call them. Whatever the man called every living creature, that became its name. The man gave names to all the livestock and to the birds of the sky and to every wild animal, but for Adam no helper was found who was suitable partner for him. The Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. As the man slept, the Lord God took a rib and closed up the flesh where it had been. The Lord God built a woman from the rib that had taken from the man and brought her to the man. The man said, "Now this one is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She will be called woman because she was taken out of man. For this reason, a man will leave his father and his mother and will remain united with his wife, and they will become one flesh." This is God's word. Now please join with me in the psalm for today, which is Psalm 121. And we'll read it responsively. I'll read the first line and you the second, and we'll join in together in the refrain and the Gloria. Keep me as the apple of your eye. Hide me in the shadow of your wings. I will lift my eyes to the hills. My help comes from the Lord. He will not let your foot slip. Indeed, he who watches over Israel, keep me as the apple of your eye. Hide me in the shadow of your wings. The Lord watches over you. The Lord will keep you from all harm. The Lord will watch over your coming and going. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Keep me as the apple of your eye. Hide me in the shadow of your wings. Please arise now for the gospel, which comes to us from the Gospel of St. John, chapter 2. Here we see Jesus doing his first miracle, but he does it at a wedding. And when Jesus is there at a wedding and in a marriage, that marriage is blessed. 3 days later, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee. Jesus' mother was there. Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no more wine." Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does that have to do with you and me? My time has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." 6 stone water jars, which the Jews used for ceremonial cleaning, were standing there, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus told them, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." And they did. When the master of the banquet tasted the water that had now become wine, he did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. The master of the banquet called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and when the guests have had plenty to drink, then the cheaper wine. You save the good wine until now." This, the beginning of his miraculous signs, Jesus performed in Cana of Galilee. He revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is God's word. Please be seated now, and let's join in singing "God of Love and God of Marriage." Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Savior Jesus Christ, who blessed marriage and continues to do that to this very day. Amen. As you know, today is St. Valentine's Day. And I don't know, but it seems like today much more is made of this day than it used to be, at least when I was younger. That might be a misunderstanding, or it might be where I grew up, I don't know. But I know my wife and I never really made a big deal of Valentine's Day. The reason is we figured just like Thanksgiving, it shouldn't just be one day a year. It should be every day, not only to give thanks to God, but to praise God by our relationship. But we live in a world today that has skewed what godly relationships are all about, and in fact, has made marriage a dirty thing. But not so our God, who uses marriage to bless the world and also to bless us, his people, and society. So today, as we look at our final roadblock to a blessed new year, this one here is a roadblock to relationships, a roadblock to a blessed marriage. We glean our understanding, of course, from God's Word, who speaks to us, the Spirit speaking through his holy writer, St. Paul, as he talks to us today about the relationship and the roles of men and women, and also of husbands and wives. Let's listen to what God has to say from Ephesians chapter 5. And by submitting to one another in reverence for Christ, wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, just as Christ is the head of the church, his body, which he himself is the Savior. Moreover, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives are to submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives in the same way as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy by cleansing her with the washing of water in connection with the word. He did this so that he could present her to himself as a glorious church, having no stain or wrinkle or any such thing, but so that she would be holy and blameless. In the same way, husbands have an obligation to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. To be sure, no one has ever hated his own body, but nourishes and cherishes it just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a great mystery. But I'm talking about Christ and the church. In any case, each of you also is to love his wife as himself, and each wife is to respect her husband. This is God's word. There are roadblocks to a blessed marriage and actually any blessed relationship. And the first reason that we have trouble in relationships, the first roadblock is because often we have a misunderstanding about this crazy word, submission. I found that to be true in many marriage problems that arose, or any relational problems, is that we don't understand what St. Paul meant when he said we submit ourselves to one another out of reverence for Christ. You notice the word submission here isn't about somebody submitting you. It's not about slavery. It's not forced. It's not coerced. This is a willing submission because of our faith in Jesus Christ, out of reverence for Christ. And so we submit to one another as an act of our own will towards somebody else. It's just another way, I think, of saying love your neighbor as yourself, isn't it? For the good of someone else, I'm willing to step back from my position and my place to help somebody, to be there for somebody, to care for somebody. Our world doesn't understand that because we are all not blessed But we're all cursed with having this thing in us called the sinful nature, which always wants to elevate self above everybody else. We call it pride. We call it arrogance. And boy, when you live in close relationships, that shows up all too often. And instead of a willing submission to one another out of reverence for Christ, it comes out as a shouting match, vying for the top dog position. It's certainly not biblical leadership if it's in a relationship in His church, His kingdom. It's about loving your neighbor as yourself. And it's based on Christ. Why? Do you remember what Christ did? Jesus Christ, God's Son, submitted, the same word, to the will of His Father. He wasn't forced to come into this world and be localized in time and space. He was not forced to live a life of humiliation. He was not forced to take the spitting and the beating and the crown of thorns, much less the judgment of humans. He was not forced to go to the cross. He did it of His own free will for sinners who deserve none of it. To make us holy, that's the picture of willing submission that should be in the lives of every single person, especially us, God's people, His body, His bones and flesh, as Paul says here. And so we submit to one another. This is an act of God's grace in us. This can only happen when we understand Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. But boy, it gets in the way in every relational problem, doesn't it? Because we forget this. Yeah, those sinful attitudes come out. I want what I want when I want it, and how dare you tell me otherwise? Those of us who have been blessed in our marriages to have children, oh, we see that image of ourselves in them doing the very same thing all the time. And now I witness it in my grandchildren. Sin certainly has passed down generation to generation. Learning to submit to one another out of reverence for Christ is a key ingredient in a blessed relationship, no matter what the relationship is, but certainly in the relationship we call marriage. And on Valentine's Day, I wanted to talk about that wrongful attitude against submission that leads to so many roadblocks to a blessed marriage and thus a blessed new year. Now, St. Paul first talks about having the right kind of attitude. And then he goes into talking about the right kind of understanding of the roles of marriage. You see, misunderstanding the roles in relationship, the male-female role, also leads to problems because God set it up this way. I know Paul later says it's a mystery. Well, it is. I mean, I don't know why God did that, but He did. That's the way He created us. And He established that before sin came into the world. Don't forget that. So the misunderstanding of roles. Let's talk first about the head-helper relationship, because that's really what the Scriptures talks about. Established by the Lord at creation was this understanding that the male, Adam, which by the way is the word Adam, dust in the Hebrew, and it actually means male dirt. Wives, you can use that sometimes, I suppose. But before the fall into sin, God established this head-helper relationship, and we just read it before. God brings Adam into the Garden of Eden and has all of these animals pass before him, birds, creeping things. And He names them. God says, right, that's their name. But it says in the Scripture, no suitable helper was found for him. Why did the Lord bring those animals in front of Adam? He was to see by that there was no corresponding person for him, like there was for the animals. This is critical. God created humans with a purpose. In fact, three purposes. One of them was to subdue the earth, use science for the good of mankind. They were supposed to also care for the creation. It's mankind's job to take care of God's world. And then the other one, and that's to have children and increase the population of the earth. That was the threefold purpose that God gave for the relationship we've come to call marriage. And Adam could not do any of them without somebody to help him. And so we read in the scriptures, God said, "It's not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him." Now that concept of helper suitable is really hard to translate because it takes a paragraph really to translate that Hebrew concept. Basically what it's saying, that head helper situation is saying that God is going to create somebody for Adam that perfectly fits together with him in every possible way. Mentally, spiritually, physically, men and women were built to fit together. They were built by God to work together, the head and the helper, not in a subservient boss kind of relationship, but side by side to carry out God's purpose for his world. Unfortunately, sin really messed that up. And yet we have a pattern for this kind of headship when the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 11 says, "I want you to realize that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of the woman is man, and the head of Christ is God." You see, even God and his Son, according to his state of Savior, is subject to his Father. You see that? It's not an ungodly thing or a minimalizing or a negative thing to understand the head-helper relationship. Paul then goes into talking about the difference between the roles of men and women as it pertains specifically to marriage. The roles. There's no difference before God between male and female. We're all one in Christ, correct? But he gives us different roles to play, different jobs to do, if you will. And he talks about the role of wives when he says, "Wives, submit to your husbands." Now look at the next line, "as to the Lord. For as the husband is the head of the wife, just as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he himself is the Savior. Moreover, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives are supposed to submit to their husbands in everything." Now, you notice that the Apostle Paul takes the woman first. It's kind of like what God did in after the fall. He first talks to the woman about the consequences of her sin, and then he talks to the man. Now, I don't know if Paul had that in mind, but I thought that when I was studying this again. And you see here that the wife is supposed to be the church figure in the relationship. Did you catch that? As the church submits to Christ, did you catch that? And again, the word submit is just using the same word we just talked about. And so we have the picture of Christ and his church being played out in a very practical way in a marriage. That's kind of cool, I think. The hard thing here is that our world skews everything, doesn't it? Tries to say, if you're in this relationship and have this role, ladies, that you are lesser, less important than the male. That's not what's being said here. It's how do we act out according to God's creation plan. And as the church submits to Christ, so wives are supposed to submit to their husbands. And then we have those two words there, in everything. Boy, is that demeaning, huh? Now, if we didn't have the next section about the role of the male, this would be really hard for females, I believe. It's hard enough in a world that for over 100 years now is saying, this isn't true. In everything. Why is that possible? Well, it's only possible in a marriage where Christ is at the head. Because a husband wouldn't ask his wife to do something that was contrary to God's word. And so there is one exception to in everything. If a husband or a male would say to a female or his wife, "Do this, and it's contrary to God's word," then we ought to obey God rather than men. Okay? This is in carte blanche. But that's the role. But how hard is it to keep now that we were born into sin? This is a hard thing to do. And I'm not trying to minimize it, and I'm not trying to speak down or belittle our ladies. But it's something we need to hear once in a while, because our world never talks about a proper relationship. Sin gets in the way of this too, how hard to keep. The role of rebellion gets in the way of carrying out, the roadblock of rebellion gets in the way of carrying out our role. That's what happened to Eve in the garden too, didn't it? She went outside of her God-given helper position and took the lead. But who gets the responsibility for the first sin? Adam. He abdicated his position as the head to protect his wife and follow God's word. But that's for another Bible class and another sermon. Let's go to the next one, the role of the husband. This one I understand personally because I am one. Both male, I think, yeah. And a husband, too, for 4+ decades. That's a long time to be married in today's culture. And I can tell you, you don't get through even a couple of years without the grace of God. Especially our younger years, where we're all fretted. We don't have that stability of experience. But the role of the husband is also critical. And Paul spends a whole lot more verses on the male. Did you catch that? Husbands, love your wives in the same way as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. And just then, we should just pack it in. Not one of us males has ever done that perfectly. But we ought to be striving for that, don't you think? Loving our wives, loving our ladies, as Christ loved the church. That was an all kind of love, wasn't it? That was a complete love that put the church in front of himself. That's why he went to the cross. You see, he gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her with the water, washing of water in connection with God's word. I think he's referring to baptism there, isn't he? He did this so that he could present her to himself as a glorious church, having no stain or wrinkle or any such thing, but so that she would be holy and blameless. Husbands, love your wives this way. You know, most of us didn't see our wives in their wedding dresses until they started walking up the aisle. Is that true for all of us or not? I mean, some people just got married at justice of a peace, or it was a kind of a private wedding. But still, I still remember that part of my wedding. I didn't remember a lot of it. I remember that our pastor preached for 45 minutes for our wedding. I guess we needed a lot of God's word to go forward. But one thing I do remember is Liz coming up the aisle, first time I saw her in her wedding dress. And I can tell you, to this day, that was really glorious. You know, the sun was kind of behind her in the windows. And just beautiful, clean. I did nothing to present her without a stain or without wrinkles. I had nothing to do with that, at least not on our wedding day. But Christ, what does he do for each of us who wear the spotted garment of our own righteousness and our sin? What does Christ do for us, his bride? He washes us so that we're radiant before God. And how does he do it? He does it with his holy, precious blood shed on the cross. And he's washed us clean so that we, his people, can walk down the aisle, the path to eternal life in heaven. What a blessing. Husbands, love your wives the same way. I don't know about you guys, but I feel like a failure most of the time in my husband role, simply because I can't do what Christ expects of me. Thank God he did it for me and is my substitute. And that's the kind of attitude I believe we should have, males, in our roles as husbands and in general as men, especially towards our helpers. Now, if we have that kind of attitude, we're never going to put our foot down and try to squash our spouse. Yes, indeed, the role of the husband is not an easy one. In fact, it's an impossible one. But he goes on, in the same way, husbands have an obligation to love their own wives as their own body, because he who loves his wife loves himself. To be sure, no one has ever hated his own body, but nourishes and cherishes it just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body, of his flesh, of his bones. That nourishing and cherishing is really important part of our roles as men, as husbands. To nourish and care for our wives begins with nourishing and setting the example of humility and faith in Jesus. That's really critical to a healthy relationship, one that will stand the test of all of the trials and troubles that come upon marriage, especially in our day, although I don't know if it was any easier today than it was at Paul's time. It's not easy, but boy, the blessings of marriage. You know, Christ nourishes us, doesn't he? He nourishes us with his living water and with the bread of life. He washed us clean in his blood and connected us to that blood in our baptisms, and he made us a holy bride. In the same way, husbands, you have an obligation to show that kind of love to your wives, trusting the Lord forgives you and me for our failures, so that we as head and helper in our roles can submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. And that's why marriage was established. God established marriage so that he could bring blessing to society, to the world, and to us individually through marriage. That's why it says, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. Paul quotes Genesis chapter 2, verse 24 here. God had a purpose and a plan to bless us through our marriages and society through godly marriages. And he blesses us with what I call the three C's. Have you ever heard these three C's? Children. That's an easy one. Chastity after the fall into sin. And companionship. All three things God wants to bless us with and the world through us. And that's why he established marriage. We have one more roadblock to talk about quickly today, and that's misunderstanding the relationship model that God establishes. Now, every one of us is different, I think. True? And that means every marriage is different. What works in our marriage may not work in yours. But that's okay, as long as we're reminded of the other things we just talked about, the submission and the roles. If we do that, we won't misunderstand the relationship model that God gives us. You see, God wants to bless us through the estate of marriage. What's interesting in this text is Paul, after he talks about this, the two will become one flesh, he says, this is a great mystery. It is. It's a mystery to me how any marriage makes it out of the first decade. It's a trying time. You know, the seven-year itch is not an unreality. It's something that comes from observation. You know when most marriages fail? The very first year. You know why that is? Because none of the stuff we're talking about was understood right from the start. They weren't ready for it. The next period is around 7 years. That's when you're starting to feel that, hey, maybe I got something going for me. You know, you get to be, this is normal when you get married younger, okay? When it's second, third marriages, whatever, that's a different ball game. But you get around 30, you know? Now you have a couple of toddlers running around. And they cause a lot of trouble. Because now you have to raise kids and build a marriage and do your jobs and all of a sudden the pressures of life get there. Well, if you get through that one, then the next one's around 20 years. That's when the kids start leaving home and you become empty nesters. And so many people live for their children instead of for their marriage. And that's a big mistake. Parents aren't there to live for their kids. They're there to raise their kids and train them up in the Lord Jesus and set them out because they should be trained to live on their own at that point. by God's grace, it happens by His grace. I mean, it's not easy. But how do you get to your senior years? I'm not quite, well, I guess I am, but I don't think I am. How do you make it past 40 and past 50? I'll let you know in 10 years how you make it past 40. But I do know something very special. And you know this too, that God has blessed my wife and me through our marriage of these 41 years in a way that I never could imagine. So, God blesses marriage, and He blesses those who live in it. And so God is praised by our godly relationships, so pray for them. Pray for them. It's not easy. We need the strength of God. You know, where two sinners live so closely together, that's not an easy thing. But listen to the Lord God as He invites your prayers for your times of strain and struggle. And this is true also for other relationships. Keep that in mind, because when we live in a godly way, He's going to bless it. He doesn't bless sin. Which brings us to the third part of the relationship model, and that's the way the unbelieving world looks at it. We live in a world today where marriage has been so discredited, and so many breakups have happened that so many young people today don't know the difference in the roles or how marriage is supposed to work, because they have no example. They haven't seen it. You know how kids learn how to talk, right? They're listening to others talk, especially their parents. How are they going to learn about marriage if the marriage is busted? And now we're busted generationally. 4 and 5 generations of broken marriages, those poor kids. The world looks at marriage as a terrible thing. And so I don't have to go through it. I won't even get married. So we have so many people living outside of marriage today as if they were. That is not godly, and God doesn't bless it. Then you have the thing with roles of gender being all messed up today. True? Now this isn't the place to get into all of that. But it's no wonder the world has no clue of how to live together. And we're seeing it now across the board when you have something like COVID making people stay home and not building their relationships. Oh my, oh my. The world really needs a change of heart. And the only way to get that, of course, is listening to God's word. You know, I started at the outset by talking about Valentine's Day. And it's interesting, you know, how it got to be where it is today comes from the fact that right before he was executed, Valentine wrote a note to one of the children of the jailer who was going to take him to his execution. And he wrote a note on there. We don't know what the note is anymore, but it was written on there to encourage that child. Okay? He was being very positive. And he didn't have, you know, like a nice notepad. And that little piece of paper looked kind of like a heart. And that's where those Valentines come from. But the devil did something with this, like he does for so many things, even in marriage, and he flips it upside down. Instead of emphasizing the fact that here's a Christian godly pastor and a doctor who's sharing the love of Christ with somebody, they turn it into something kind of mundane if you put it up to that. Oh, he did it with Christmas too. Now we got a jolly old Saint Nicholas instead of Jesus Christ's birth. Or Easter, let's go hop along with the bunny and see the eggs that the bunny lays. I always thought that was weird. Instead of Jesus' resurrection. And the world is a battlefield for God's truth. And it seems like we're losing, but remember, Christ has overcome the world. He gave Himself up for us. And let's let that be our motive, our encouragement, and our comfort as we live together, because where sin abounds, grace abounded all the more. And so with that, I could say, have a happy Valentine's Day. Please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for all the relationships you give us in life, especially for that one most important one, our marriages. For those that haven't been married yet, we pray that you would help them find godly relationship through which they can serve you as head and helper in that relationship. Lord, for those who are struggling in their marriage, we pray for your strength through your word and sacrament that they be able to work out whatever sin has produced there. For those who are without a spouse now because you ended their marriage with death the proper way or because sin ended it, we pray for your strength and courage to live. And finally, for those who are married again, we pray that this time you bless them with this understanding so that they can live for you in a godly way. In all things, we pray, bless marriage and family. In Jesus' name, amen. Please arise now and join with me as we confess the Christian faith. This morning, we use the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand.
Amen. Please be seated as we sing Our Father by Whose Name, hymn 501. Please arise and join with me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, you created Adam and Eve for each other and gave them children. We praise you for the blessing for us and for all people through our marriages and families. We thank you for the protection, shelter, food, clothing, love, guidance, education, and especially the opportunity to share with one another the true and saving faith. We certainly remember our sins of anger, grudges, violence, disobedience, harsh words, and unloving action toward other members of our families, to our spouses, and to others in our relationship in the body of Christ. And we certainly are ashamed of these sins. We beg your forgiveness for Jesus' sake. Instead, give us patience, understanding, and love in every instance of relationship. Give us joy and delight in our homes and in our relationships. Help fathers and mothers, husbands and wives, provide for each other those things that we cherish, our nourishment from the Word of God, as well as the other things we need for emotional, physical, and spiritual needs. Lord, we also pray in these times that you would lead those who make decisions in society to keep your establishment of marriage a priority. Lord, if it's your will, we pray that you would curb Satan's pushing of all these things that destroy what you have created and set in motion. Lord, help us to love one another and the body of Christ as we encourage and support one another with prayer and whatever other things we have. And help us all show to the elderly a concern for their needs, because they too are in the family of believers. Lord, all of these things and many more things that we need to pray about in our relationships, we bring to you now in our private petitions and prayers. Lord, we thank you for making us members of your family of believers through the washing that's connected with the Word through baptism. Help us live as your children, secure in your love. We pray this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now receive with believing hearts the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Please be seated now as we listen to our final song sung by our Martin Luther College choir. pray that God would bless your relationships wherever they are and with whomever you have them, especially in marriage and family. We pray for that. And God grant you a blessed week, remembering also that this Wednesday is Ash Wednesday, and so the season of Lent begins, those 40 days, not counting Sundays, that lead up to our remembrance of what Christ did for us on his cross and that God raised him to life Easter Sunday. God bless your week in Jesus.